Good morning, good morning. It's good to see your lovely faces this morning. We have a couple quick announcements for you. Next Sunday from 9 to 10 a.m., we are doing a Speed the Light fundraiser. We're selling some biscuits and gravy. If you love biscuits and gravy and you enjoy not cooking breakfast, we got you covered on both ends. Speed the Light is a missions organization that our 6th through 12th graders here at Valley Community Church raise money to send to our missionaries to help them buy a vehicle. We help them buy, if they're in a place where they have camels or donkeys, we help them buy transportation so that they can take the gospel to people who don't know about Jesus. It changes year to year, but they approximate that for every dog given to Speed the Light, that 3 people hear about the good news of Jesus. So we're speeding, we're increasing through transportation, the good news of Jesus. And so we have a Speed the Light coordinator for our youth, Sarah, and she is doing a fundraiser next week for biscuits and gravy. So you'll see some stuff on Facebook just as a reminder. As how many of you know that the announcement today, you're going to forget for next week. We have one. Yeah, we got to memorize. All right. Baptism service, November 24th. If you or someone in your family or you know of someone that's been wanting to get water baptized, we have a baptism service November 24th. If you would like to, come find you find Pastor Rachel, Pastor Ryan, or myself. I was saying, like, I said Pastor Ryan. If you pick Pastor Ryan or me, there's a 99% chance that we're going to forget. So go to Rachel or Maddie. Or Pastor Randy. We're excited about our baptism service. Are you ready to worship Jesus this morning? I want to read to you from Psalms chapter 9. I will praise you, O Lord, with all my heart. I will tell of your wonders. I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing of praises to your name, O Most High. My enemies turn back. They stumble and perish before you. For you have upheld my right and my cause. You have sat on your throne, judging righteously. You have rebuked the nations, destroyed the wicked. You have blotted out their name forever and ever. Endless ruin has overtaken the enemy. You have uprooted their cities. Even the memory of them has perished. The Lord reigns forever. He has established his throne for judgment. He will judge the world in his righteousness. He will govern the peoples with his justice. The Lord is a refuge for the oppressed, a stronghold in the times of trouble. Those who know your name will trust in you. For you, Lord, have never forsaken those who seek you. Sing praises to the Lord enthroned in Zion. Father, we come to you this morning. We sing a praise to your name. You are the King of Kings. You are the Lord of Lords. And Lord, we magnify and glorify your name this morning. We come to a place of repentance in each one of our hearts to turn away and to walk toward you, to focus on you. And we sing a song to you this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Will you stand to your feet as we praise Jesus this morning? Be set free.
chaos back into order. Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of Glory, the King of Glory, who rules the nation with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of Glory, the King above all kings. There is nothing worth more that will ever come.
Nothing like a wake-up call, is there? I don't want to leave this place, though. Sometimes the enemy will put distractions in our way to try to get us to take our focus in another direction, but let's not leave this place yet. That song says, let us become aware of your presence. It's easy to become aware of what's going on around us or who's beside us or when a microphone messes up, but we want to become aware of your presence, God. It's your presence that we long for. It's your presence that we need. Oh, Holy Spirit. Can we just sing that again, Pastor Shane? Let us become aware. Let's just sing that just a little bit more. Hallelujah.
Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your good.
think as a church, we need to pray over the elections upcoming on Tuesday. I pray that each of you have sought the Holy Spirit. I want to read a passage of Scripture. It's in Revelation chapter 3. Jesus is speaking to seven different churches in Revelation chapter 2 and 3. He says this to the church of Philadelphia. These are the words of the Holy One, the true One, the one who has the key of David, who opens and no one will shut, and who shuts and no one will open. Verse 8, I know your works. Behold, I have set before you an open door which no one is able to shut. I know that you have but little power, and yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. We've been praying for open doors. But when you pray for open doors, you pray, say, God, keep open the ones that you want open and shut the ones that you want shut. And when you shut a door, God, help us. How many of you ever forced open a door that he shut? And only to find out, wait a minute, I shouldn't have done that. I know I have. Many of you know that we've been praying for God to continue to expand our territory. That's straight out of Isaiah. And we've been working with another community about the possibility of setting up a campus church. 3 weeks ago, that door shut. It's okay to have shut doors, right? And I had to go to that place because I'd been working with them for several months. And had to go to that place, get a little grumpy, be a little frustrated, but say, okay, God, if you shut this door, I'm not going to force it. I'm not going to force it open. 3 weeks later, to the date, another community called. He said, Pastor Ryan, we want to know more about what you want to do in our community. So what God shuts, I promise you, he will make another way for you. We continue to pray for us as a leadership team. We don't want to get so busy with going through open doors that we don't hear what the Lord is speaking. We want to hear what you're speaking. We need to hear what he's speaking right now to us as his people. Pastor David, would you come and make your way? How many of you know we just need to cover this election with our prayers? I've asked Pastor David just to pray before we transition to anything else.
In the book of Isaiah in chapter 11, there was a prophecy over the coming king who was Jesus. And the prophecy said that he sought the Spirit of the Lord. He was going to not believe what people said, what his ears heard, or what his eyes saw, but he was going to press in to hear his Father. In this time, in this season of our lives, in this season of our country, we must press in to hear the Spirit of the Lord. Because there's deceivement beyond our human understanding in the spirit realm. For God wants us to seek him. And if you've never done it, I would encourage you to consider tomorrow to fast and pray one day before you make your decisions, that you would be led by the Holy Spirit. And then specifically ask Holy Spirit to lead you, not only in one election, but in all of the elections, that we ask God on the community level, state level, federal level, that we'd be led by Holy Spirit. We cannot make it as a people unless we hear the Spirit of the Lord. That's why Jesus warned every church, seven churches, he who has ears to hear, let him hear what the Holy Spirit says. So if you want to start at the grassroots level, lay your hands on your ears and ask the Holy Spirit to give you ears to hear what Holy Holy Spirit says. Father, we lift up not only our nation, but our community, that we'd be a people to choose and to select men and women that are after your heart, that are sensitive to obedience to you, that have the fear of the Lord in their lives at the state level and the national level. We want to be a people that are responsible for hearing your voice. For we know that you will come and reward those who follow you, who have a fear of the Lord. And Father, we can't believe everything we see or everything we hear. Just like Jesus, we must hear the Father and the heart of the Father. I pray right now for an anointing of grace to seek your face in this room, on this people, that we would definitely seek you and ask. We would not assume, because the voices of the world are very confusing. We must hear your voice. For you're a God that does not have confusion. But you have order and love, that we'd be led by the Spirit of the Lord. I pray for a revelation on this people, on every family, on this community, that we would hear your voice. And we thank you for the Spirit of God that will move upon our hearts to draw near to you. Because you love us with an everlasting love, we thank you. Father, let us not be in a hurry, but linger in your presence like Joshua lingered in your presence in the Old Testament. When Moses was leading, he still lingered in your presence. Let us be men and women that linger in your presence to hear your voice. Let there be blessing and peace in Jesus' name. And we command the peace of God to rule in our hearts and in this nation. And in coming days, God, would you raise up godly men and women preparing to be in office in the future years? Father, we can't just think about the moment now. We need to think about the future. And so we ask that you would anoint men and women, godly men and women, to rise up and to take their place of responsibility and leadership. And so we speak and prophesy that you would raise up men and women that fear you, that are not afraid to go and be leaders in communities, in the states, nationally and internationally, that you'd raise up godly men and women of influence and godly character for your name's sake and for your kingdom's sake. In Jesus' name, amen.
You all can be seated. You can shake a hand if you want, but you can be seated. If you're a guest here this morning, we want to welcome you and say thank you for choosing to worship with us. We have a visitor card in front of you. Lord's good, isn't he? I love it when Pastor David lets the Holy Spirit speak through him.
Amen.
We do have a visitor card. It's got a QR code if you want. Otherwise, you can fill it out and stick it in the offering stations throughout the church. And if you have a prayer request, we want to also give you that opportunity to share a prayer request. And Father, I thank you so much for the opportunity to share your word today, to be here in your church. I think most of the time before I preach, I just ask that you would give us ears to hear what your Spirit saying to us. Lord, I thank you again for these people. We pray that you would be with Pastor Jerry as he preaches this morning of your death. Bless that church. God, bring health and vitality into that community, into that church. God, thank you for what you're doing. We love you in Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Thanks, Kyle. In 1989, anybody remember 1989? How many of you honestly remember 89? Okay. You're looking at me. Oh, yes. Sorry. Middle school students, you guys can be dismissed. Middle school students, thank you, Elijah. Elijah's back there giving me the stink signal and pointing, so thank you, buddy. 1989, I was given an opportunity to travel abroad, to go overseas. I went to the Soviet Union, to Russia, for 4 weeks. We were there on an exchange program that six students from Dodge City went with. I think there was 27 total from the state of Kansas, and we went over there and experienced their way of life. We wanted to see how they lived. In fact, we were some of the first Americans in at least two communities that we traveled to. We went to countries, Lithuania, Latvia, Belarus. Anybody remember those names? I was even in this country most of you heard of recently called Ukraine. I was in the Ukraine. I was in Kiev. And we went there for 4 weeks. I was in Red Square in Moscow. We drove by the Kremlin just to see if they would pull us over and arrest us, because I knew they knew that we were there. I think one of the most unique experiences that I had in Russia was in a town called Leningrad. It's called St. Petersburg now. But I was in a hotel, and we were coming down. I was just by myself. We were up on the 19th floor, and I got inside the elevator, and about between the second and the first floor, the elevator suddenly stopped, and I couldn't get the doors to open. Anybody claustrophobic in here? Anybody love elevators? Who loves elevators? Okay. Who hates elevators? Me. I hate them with the passion. So I'm a 16-year-old boy stuck in a foreign country. I can speak about five words in Russian, and all the buttons on that elevator were in what language? Thank God for universal symbols such as an alarm. You know, and I'm trying to communicate with these people. For 2 hours, 2 hours, I was stuck inside of an elevator in Russia. It was a very unique moment. It was a hair-tingling moment. I had heard somewhere that if you begin to remove clothing, that the feelings of claustrophobia will go away. So slowly, can you imagine what it was like for these Russian dudes opening up this elevator, see a young 16-year-old American boy in his underwear? I'm not kidding. True story. I got all the way down to my skivvies. I was covered in sweat. I can kind of remember them, but their eyes were like this big. And I just thanked them. That's one Russian word that I will never forget is placebo, which means thank you. And I just kept saying thank you, thank you. I couldn't get those doors to open. No matter how I tried. I stuck my finger and I ended up getting it about an inch apart. But I couldn't get those doors to open. We were there from most of June of 1989. Following our departure, remember 27 high school students from Kansas, but following our departure, something began to take place in Eastern Europe. Communism began to what? Crumble. By the end of 1989, Poland, Czechoslovakia, Romania, Hungary, Bulgaria, all of these countries left that communist oppression. The finale occurred in November 9th, 1989. Many of you probably remember this moment if you're around my age or older than my age, when the Berlin Wall began to fall. I remember, it's like this reel inside of my head that never goes away, but it was 1987 when our president at that time, Ronald Reagan, Mr. Gorbachev, tear down these walls. And people begin to experience a freedom unlike never before. Freedom in who they were, freedom in worship. Eventually, following that moment, the Soviet Union broke up in 1991. Now, was it because some 27 high school students from Kansas was there? Probably not. But the things that God begins to open, no man can shut. And the doors that God closes, no man can open. found it very fascinating to watch this unfold in front of my high school eyes. I couldn't get enough news seeing people who were under oppression experience freedom. One of the things that we did while we were there, we decided to see what it meant to stand in line. We stood in line for 2.5 hours to get one loaf of bread. And this was a normal thing. I still have the roll of toilet paper that I brought from Russia. It's in a little special place, but it is the nastiest, roughest stuff you can ever imagine in your entire life. But people would wait in line just for the basic necessities, but to see the freedom take place, and there's still freedom that God's allowing. But what I watched was missionaries. When those curtains, the iron curtain, when it began to fall, missionaries started going into places that once had closed doors, and God began to open up those doors, and people were not just experiencing freedom from a tyrannical government, but they were experiencing freedom in Jesus. And is there nothing better than that? Freedom in their worship, freedom in Jesus. And the church started experiencing exponential growth. Elijah, will you put that picture up? No, not that one. Not that one. The next one, right there. How many remember that? Tiananmen Square. They never found out, to our knowledge, at least to America's knowledge, who that man was that stood in front of those tanks. And when the tanks tried to go, how many of you remember this? How many of you have no idea what I'm talking about? It was so intense. And we were in Russia during this event. We were being told all kinds of things because Russia and China were partners at that time. But I'll never forget seeing videos after I got back of this man standing alone. These tanks were being sent to destroy the lives of students who were protesting, who said our freedom is important. They were protesting. You're going to get a little Chinese lesson. Is that okay? In 1966, there was a ruler. He began his rule in the early 40s, Mao Zedong. From 1966 to 1976, Mao Zedong initiated what was called the Chinese Cultural Revolution. For 10 years, he sanctioned every single church to be destroyed. And if it wasn't destroyed, he sanctioned them to be taken back and absorbed into the Chinese culture. He took pastors and deacons, tortured them, put many to death, all to get rid of one thing. Do you know what that was? Religion. Mao wanted to eradicate anything Western in China. So he started what was called the Red Army. And the Red Army were students and teenagers that were just wreaking havoc. We don't really, and we probably will never know, but somewhere between 500,000 and 2 million people were put to death during this cultural revolution. He wanted people to stop believing in God. He wanted to take any kind of intellectual thought away. He wanted to promote his vision and his power. He got rid of these four things, these four ideas that he called old. He said old things, old ideas, old customs, and old habits. Something happened during that time to the church that existed there in China. Do you know what happened? We call it the underground movement. The Iron Curtain was over Eastern Europe, but we call it the bamboo curtain that was over China. When the bamboo curtain began to lift in the early 80s, Mao died in 1976, and that's when the Cultural Revolution began to stop. They began to institute policies that people were allowed to have certain freedoms, and they allowed missionaries to come back in. In the early 80s, what they expected to be a completely decimated church, they found something different. Over 10 million that they could count Christians living in China. He didn't just destroy churches or pastors, or he even confiscated homes of religious leaders. And it wasn't just Christian, it was Catholic, and it wasn't just Catholic, it was mosques, and it wasn't just mosque, it was any kind of Buddhist temple. He would destroy them and take possession. But when they came back in, see, these Christians in China found a way to make sure the word of God didn't fall away. You know what they did? They memorized it. What? Right? What did David say? Psalms 119:11. Your word have I hid in my heart that I won't sin against you. I hide that inside my heart. And not only that, when they memorize it, they begin to write it on pieces of paper. Can you imagine my Galatians group that we've been studying? They would take one chapter that they memorized and they would write it on a piece of paper and they would hand it to this house church. And once this house church memorized it, they would hand it over to this house church. And when this house church was done, they would hand it over to another house church. The word of God, there's nothing that can shut that door, amen? And I think sometimes we get this idea, nothing will separate us from the love of God. The church thrived. 2007. It's estimated that there was over 60 million Christians in China. Bible-believing, Jesus-believing Christians in China. From the early 80s to 2007, represented a growth of about 7% every single year. Today, 17 years later, they're estimating over 200 million Jesus believers in China, still in a place where they don't express it. They're not allowed to in communist China. Atheism is the religion. The doors that God opens, no man can shut. And when God shuts a door, no man can open it. It did not stop. For the last 2 weeks, We've been sharing a story about a king by the name of Ahaz. It's in 2 Chronicles chapter 28, 2 Kings chapter 16, and Isaiah chapter 7. And it comes from our title is simply this: Spirit lead me when leaders fail to lead. It was something that the Lord began to lay on my heart back in August, and I appreciate Pastor Jared and Pastor Jerry preaching through some of this. It's not been, and I would not call it an easy situation. It's like David sharing a word that he got from the Lord and saying, Ryan, I want you to share this the best you can, even though it's mine. And Pastor Jared and Pastor Jerry have done an incredible job of sharing some of the heart that God began to do this. But I wanted to share a little bit. Maybe you haven't been here in a couple weeks. I want to share a little bit of this story. But the king of Judah at that moment was King Ahaz, and he was being attacked by the king of Israel and the king of Aram. Ahaz, instead of seeking God, he sought human intervention. How often do we do that as people? We seek human intervention instead of divine intervention. So the prophet Isaiah came to King Ahaz. You can read it in Isaiah chapter 7. And he said, you're not asking for God to help you, you're asking for man to help you. And I think sometimes we forget, that's who we need to be seeking. That's who we need to be asking. God, do your divine intervention. But he refused. And he ended up leading his kingdom to become a subordinate to another country instead of following the Lord. So I want to share, there's four things and then I'm adding two more. I'll go through these fairly fast, but I want you to see, and we'll have them up there on the screen. Number one, I want you to understand, instead of seeking divine intervention, he sought human intervention. So number one, these two kingdoms came in and destroyed Judah because he sought things from the world instead of God. So number one, God allowed this to happen. 2 Kings 16:5 says this, because of all this, the Lord his God allowed the king of Aram to defeat Ahaz and to exile large numbers of his people to Damascus. The armies of the king of Israel also defeated Ahaz and inflicted many casualties on this army. When we refuse to follow after what God has spoken to us, there are consequences, church. There are consequences. And it simply says, God allowed this to happen. Let that ruminate in your brain. Number two, the second thing the Lord did under the rulership of King Ahaz was this. He began to humble the kingdom of Judah. The king at that time, Ahaz, did two things. He encouraged the children of God to sin and be unfaithful to the Lord. To sin. Can you imagine me as your leader, as your pastor, saying, listen, church, you can begin to sin and do anything that you want, and we're going to start following a different kind of worship. What would you do to me? Hopefully, yes. Thank you. You would say, Pastor Shane, see, you would kick me out. But because of the way he was leading, the Lord began to humble the kingdom of Judah. 2 Chronicles 28:19. The Lord was humbling Judah because the king of Ahaz of Judah, for he had encouraged his people to sin and had utterly been unfaithful to the Lord. Number three, there was an economic burden on the kingdom of Judah. Fearing this attack that was coming, he began to seek out human intervention, and he took, King Ahaz took gold and silver out of the temple. That'd be like after church, Pastor Ryan, I need to pay off my truck, going back to one of those, I have the keys to those boxes, and I don't use them. But it'd be like me going in there and taking money out and using it for my own purpose. I've pastored nearly 25 years, and I can tell you not once have I ever done that. But that's what the king did. He took money out of the temple treasury. He also took valuable items from the Lord's temple. It'd be like me selling our soundboard back there that made my mic sound really bad at the beginning because I'm mad at it. But anyway, it caused an economic burden. Read 2 Chronicles 28, verse 21. Ahaz took valuable items from the Lord's temple, the royal palace, and from the homes of his officials and gave them to the king of Assyria as a tribute. Will you please help me, king of Assyria, while these other ones are trying to attack me? But read that last sentence. How did that help him? It didn't. It did not help him. Number four, there was a loss of kingdom identity for Judah, the kingdom of Judah. Realizing that he was about to get routed, realizing he was about to get defeated in a battle, he sent word to the king of Assyria. He's saying, we once were the children of God, but we're now going to become your subordinate. We want to be your vassal. We want to be your servants. 2 Kings 16:7 says this. Ahaz sent messengers to King Tiglath-Pileser of Assyria with this message. I am your servant and your vassal. Do you see where he was then? Hear my heart. Spirit lead us when leaders fail to lead. Number five. These are the two that I want to just share a little bit more in depth. Judah changed who and how they worshiped as a kingdom. Grab that. They changed who and how they worshiped as a kingdom. So here the king of Judah, King Ahaz, left to go to Damascus to meet with the king of Assyria. And in his attempt to bribe on his way there, he saw this beautiful altar. And they had an altar in the temple, an altar that God had instructed Moses how to build. And he noticed this altar, and so I don't know if he took out a tape measure and began to take measurements about how tall and how long and how wide and what color it was and all the different routes. He didn't have a cool phone to snap a picture or a Snapchat or do something on Instagram back then, but he sent word back to his priest and said, Uriah, I want you to make this temple, this altar, and I want you to take the altar that's already in the temple that God directed, and I want you to pull it out, and I want you to put this new altar in. scary times for the kingdom of Judah. I still don't fully understand why Uriah did what he asked as a priest. I cannot fully understand that. But he set the detailed plans and he wanted it built. Look with me in 2 Kings chapter 16, verse 10, and you can read along with me. There's several slides there, Elijah. Verse 10. King Ahaz then went to Damascus to meet the king of Assyria. I already butchered that name once. Don't ask me to do it again. While he was there, he took special note. Have you ever been at somebody's house and you see a piece of furniture that they have and you go, I like that. Where'd you get that? I want to buy that. He took note, special note, of that altar. He sent the model of the altar to Uriah the priest along with its design in full detail. Verse 11. Uriah followed the king's instructions and built an altar just like it, and it was ready before the king returned from Damascus. Verse 12. When the king returned, he inspected the altar and made offerings on it. He presented a burnt offering and a grain offering. He poured out a liquid offering and he sprinkled the blood of the peace offering on the altar. A worship system that the Lord started was changed by a man. He took the altar out, the altar that they would use to make their sacrifices to the Lord as a token of their sins. And this king changed it. Verse 14. Then King Ahaz removed. That right there should just, already my heart's pounding. He removed the old bronze altar from its place in front of the Lord's temple between the entrance and the new altar. And he placed it on the north side of the new altar. Then he told Uriah the priest, start using that new altar. Change the way they worshiped. Literally brought in counterfeit worship into the temple of the Lord. The very altar that the Lord instructed Moses on Mount Sinai. Here King Ahaz of Judah is changing it. Not just how they worship, but they directly undermine the instructions of the Lord. And I don't know about you, I don't want to be in the thunderstorm next to somebody who's undermining the things of the Lord. So Ahaz continued to reject the Lord. Look at 2 Chronicles 28, verses 22 and 23. Even during this time of trouble. Have you ever been in a time of trouble? What do you normally do? We pray. Even during this time of trouble, King Ahaz continued to do what? Reject. In Isaiah chapter 7, the prophet came to him and said, God has given you the opportunity to ask for any kind of sign that he wants to provide divine intervention for you. And it says that he refused. And the ultimate was that he continued to reject the Lord there in 2 Chronicles 28, verse 23, let's look. He offered sacrifices to the gods of Damascus who had defeated him. He's doing this in the temple of the Lord, guys. He's creating a sacrificial system for false gods and false deity, and he's doing it in the presence of the Lord. And he said this, since these gods helped the kings of Aram, they will help me too if I sacrifice to them. But instead, grab this one. Instead, they led to his ruin and the ruin of all Judah. Not just the king, but also the kingdom. The last thing that Ahaz did, and I want you to grab this one too, is number 6. The temple of the Lord was closed. The last lesson that we learned from his demise, his refusal, his rejection to follow what God, ending up with him shutting the doors of the temple so no one could worship. Read this with me, 2 Chronicles 28, verse 24, 25. The king took various articles from the temple of God and he broke them into pieces. things that they were using to worship, things that they had brought in on the instruction of God through Moses. And they broke them into pieces. He shut the doors of the Lord's temple so that no one could worship there. And he set up altars to pagan gods in every corner of Jerusalem. There was a downfall that was happening in the kingdom of Judah because the leader wasn't leading. A man chosen. He's from the lineage of David. He knows right from wrong. He has access to the prophet of God. And what's he continuing to do? He's continuing to refuse and reject God to the point that he said no one could worship. Verse 25, he made pagan shrines in all the towns of Judah for offering sacrifices to other gods. King Ahaz led his people away from the Lord. The heritage of his kingdom and his bloodline, he said, it's no longer my concern. He took the articles that they used for worship and broke them into pieces and he discarded them, furthering people with the ability to worship. And then he had other altars built. Ahaz's leadership ends this way. 2 Chronicles 28:25. In this way, he aroused the anger of the Lord, the God of his ancestors. A man who refused to do what was right, leading his kingdom to sin and utterly reject God. What would it have been like? How many of you had the door open for you this morning when you walked into church? Hopefully most of you. Nobody opened the door on that door. I opened it myself because I was here early. Hopefully most of you had the door. Can you imagine what it was like? What it would be like if you walked up to the church on a Sunday morning after getting an extra hour of sleep. Everybody said, amen. And you walk up and people are there behind the glass doors, and you see him, and you go, what did it make you feel like? Pastor Jared and I were in my office in a meeting, and we had a worship team practice for a women's conference. By the way, is it too late to sign up? Are you sure? What are you up to now? They're up. Women's conference. Next Saturday, there are over 210 ladies that have signed up from our region. Come on, how cool is that? It's still not too late, apparently, to sign up. That's a good little sidekick moment right there. And I totally forgot what I was going to say. Oh, yeah. Doors shut, doors locked, can't get in. What's going on in the church? Why aren't they letting us in? The greeters are there, but there's no intention. If that happened, you would probably turn around and... Now I remember I was talking about Doug. I just looked over and saw. Jared and I were in a meeting, and Doug was locked out. And he said he rang the doorbell about 5 times, and for some reason we did not hear him. And he came in and gave us a hard time. But literally, if you could not get in, you would turn around and walk away. And this is what's happening. I want to have the worship team come back up. And if you don't know me very well, that's my way of saying I'm winding down. Do you realize that the enemy's intentions today for the church are no different than his intentions in 1966? The enemy wants to destroy what God has established, the church, the bride of Christ. But I came to this thought. Can the doors be shut? Can the doors of the church be shut? Would you believe it or not that Jesus had something to say about this? I told Leah, I said, I'm going to bring it back to Jesus. Earlier this week when they were picking out worship songs, he says, that's a really good idea, Pastor, right? But I want to bring it back to Jesus. Jesus has something to say about this. Will the doors, can the church doors be shut? Look at Matthew 23, verse 13. It's up on the screen. Jesus is speaking to religious leaders. And he says this. Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites. Jesus didn't hold back with the religious people, did he? He says this. You shut the what? The door. He's looking at these religious leaders and says, you shut the door of the kingdom. Kyle, you can go ahead and play and make me sound good. You shut the door of the kingdom of heaven in people's faces. You yourselves do not enter, nor will you let those who are trying to enter go in. Not a whole lot different than King Ahaz. Actually, you can bring that down a little bit. You're making me sound too good. He's looking at these religious people and saying, you're refusing to let people worship. And not only that, you don't even go in. What Ahaz did in the temple during his reign in the kingdom of Judah wasn't a whole lot different than what some of the religious leaders were doing during the time of Jesus. He not only accused them of shutting the door, but he said, you guys won't even enter. And you're forbidding others to worship. May I ask that again? Can that door be shut? Can the door be shut? Let me read another verse that Jesus said. John chapter 10, starting at verse 7. So Jesus again said, truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door. Come on. I am the door of the sheep. And everybody in the room says, because you're sheep. I am the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. He says it again in verse 9. I am the door. Can the doors of the church be shut? I say no. Why? Because Jesus can't be shut down. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved, will go in and out and find pasture. That path, when you're a sheep, there's really one thing you want to do. Eat in good green pasture. But he says, you've got to enter through the door. I am the door. Jesus is the door. Not only that, he's inviting you to walk through the door. You'll experience salvation in this pasture. Pastor Emmett, that sounds pretty awesome. How's that possible? How can I walk through that door? I bet you Jesus had something to say about that too. Matthew 7, verses 7 and 8. Jesus' words again, and he says this. Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and the one who knocks, the door will be open. I think some of you need to go inside your heart and start doing this. If you're the door, God, Jesus, I believe that you're the door, and I believe that no one can shut that door. But I want to walk through your door. Ask, seek, and knock. Do you want that door opened in your life? You know what? Jesus wasn't finished yet. He wasn't done. I started by reading out of Revelation chapter 3. I about the church in Philadelphia. Let me read a passage of scripture out of Revelation 3. Verses 19 and 20. Jesus again is speaking to the church, and he says this: "Those whom I love, I rebuke and I discipline." You say, what? Would I be a good father if I didn't discipline my children when they needed it? I wouldn't. So here's Jesus saying, "For those I love, I rebuke and I discipline." So be earnest. Be earnest and do what? Repent. I don't know, this has been the theme of this three-week series. God, help us to come to a place where we repent. So be earnest and repent. And then verse 20, it says this: "Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and I will eat with that person and they with me." So not only are we knocking on his door, he's knocking on the door of our heart too, saying, "Hey, I want to spend time with you. Hey, I want to be with you. Hey, quit letting all the distractions of the world keep you from time with me." The doors of the temple have been shut over time, but I'm telling you, I've opened those doors so that you have full access to me. Church, grab a hold of it. Grab a hold of what Jesus is offering. All you've got to do is hear me knock in my voice and open that door, because I'm wanting in. I'm wanting in. Ahaz shut the doors. The religious people of Jesus' times shut the doors. There have been leaders throughout our history that have tried to shut the doors of the church. Lord, lead us to a place of repentance. Lead us to a place of repentance. What is the church? If Jesus said repent, what does the church need to repent of? He actually says it a few verses up. Verses 15 and 16 in Revelation 3, he says this. He says, "I know your deeds." He says, "I know what you're doing. I know your deeds. And you are neither cold or hot. You're neither cold nor are you hot." And then he says something like, "I wish you were either one or the other," which sounds funny sometimes because we want to be on fire. But what he's saying is that water has a purpose. How many of you like a cold drink? When I am coming out of a hot summer day in Kansas, I do not want lukewarm water. My wife wears gloves when she washes dishes. You know why? Because she washes in stinking hot water. There are times I go in to wash my hands in the dishwater after she's done washing, and I stick them in there, and hot water has a purpose too. So Jesus is speaking to the church. He said, "You're neither. I wish you were one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I'm about to spit you out of my mouth." The Greek word there for spit is Greek for vomit. He's speaking to the church. He says, "Church, I want you to have purpose. You know what the purpose is." He says, "I want you to have purpose. Stop being lukewarm. If there's something to repent of, church, hear me. If you hear anything, hear this. If there's something the church can repent of today, it's called being lukewarm. I'd rather you be hot, or I'd rather you be cold. I'd rather you have a purpose. But because sometimes you're letting things get in the way of your life, you're so distracted, you become lukewarm. You've let that dishwater sit too long. You've let that iced tea lose all its ice, and now it's just been sitting out too long. And you're not going to drink it. You're going to dump it out, and you're going to get more. Church, quit being lukewarm." We've asked this question every week. How should the church respond? How should we respond? See, this is where I get excited about King Ahaz. Even though he failed as a leader, we know he failed. Follow this. Pastor Jared talked a little bit about this. The next generation that followed him did not fail. The next generation, King Hezekiah, his own flesh and blood, his own son. Remember when we talked about how King Ahaz threw his sons into the fire as a sacrifice? I am thankful that Hezekiah missed that side. So here's the king, King Hezekiah, the son of King Ahaz, the next generation. He was a different man. Can I show you why I'm hopeful about the next generation? Now, Elijah, you can put that picture up. Put that picture up of youth convention. There it is. Pastor Jared, how many kids were there? Say that, what? 1,000? I mean, that picture really doesn't do justice of what I walked into on Friday night. If you haven't, I went live for about 15 seconds as I'm standing at the back. And I'm watching this. It's the largest physical church, and they said there's a God in Kansas. This thing is packed. And the next generation is down in the front worshiping. You know what? We need to pray against lukewarmness in the next generation. Your kids, your grandkids, God, keep them from being lukewarm. And I'll put another video. I recorded about a minute and 15 seconds of worship. And they're singing the song, "Great Are You, Lord." And I'm like, oh, I didn't want to leave. Repent of your lukewarmness. Repent means I'm going this way, but I want to go this way. Turning away from what I was doing wrong and running back to the Father, running back to Jesus. Let's have deep faith about this next generation. This is why I'll spend the rest of my life preparing for the next generation. I know my purpose. I know what God's calling me. I want this next generation. I want this next generation. What father doesn't want his kids to go farther than him? I want you to read 2 Chronicles 29, 1 through 3 with me. King Ahaz is dead. Here is his son, the next generation. Hezekiah was 25 years old. 25 when he became the king of Judah. And he reigned in Jerusalem 29 years. His mother was Abijah, the daughter of Zechariah. He did what was pleasing. Isn't that awesome? The next generation, even, listen, I know some of you are first generation Christians. I know some of you come from brokenness. I know some of you come from a place where your father or your mother weren't a great example. But you know what? You get to be that first generation that leads the next generation. I'm 5 generations deep. At least that I can go back. He did what was pleasing in the Lord's sight, just as his ancestor David, talking about King David, had done. Verse 3. In the very first month of the first year of his reign, guess what Hezekiah did? He reopened the doors. He said, I know what my daddy did. I know what the generation previously did, but it's not going to happen in this generation. We're going to reopen the doors of the temple, and we're going to repair them. Why? Because we want people to come in. We don't want people to come into a church, I don't care what community it is, and find that door shut down. There's something that's burning inside of my heart that there are places around us that need a gospel message, and he's calling us to do it, church. He's asking us, will you be a part of reopening doors. Will you be a part of reopening doors? Where my Hezekiah's at? Where my people that says, Father, I've been lukewarm and I need to repent. I've been going this way and I find myself in a place that I'm neither hot nor cold, but I've become lukewarm. I've allowed too many things to distract me from the purpose that you've created me for. I've even shut some of those doors, God, and I need to repent right now. And if you start doing this, asking and seeking and knocking, Jesus said, I will open that door. And guess what? I'm going to start knocking on the door of your heart. And it's going to open. And I'm going to come and hang out with you. Every head bowed, every eye closes. Right where you're at. I don't care how old you are. If you need to repent of lukewarmness, will you do that right now? We as a church. Because when you begin to do that, he is going to reveal purpose. I'd rather you be hot. I'd rather you be cold. But because you're lukewarm, I'm going to vomit. Come on, church. Just take a moment. If there's an area of your life where you've been lukewarm, ask the Lord to forgive, repent, start knocking. The door will be open. Some of you here need to reopen the door of your heart. Some of you here this morning, you come from a generation. Possibly you were abused. You come from a generation. You're in the next line where the generation before you didn't know Jesus. And he wants to heal some of those places of your heart if you will allow you. See, I think part of this call, where King Ahaz took away the altar, Hezekiah brought it back. He went through all the land of Judah and got all the things that his father discarded and brought them back to the temple. He purified them and got them ready to be used. As I watched yesterday and Friday night, as hundreds of students went to the altar. Not a false altar, not a fake altar, not an altar created by somebody else. But they came to the altar to repent and to change their lives and their hearts. I needed to be there to see that. Church, it's time for us to rise up. The worship team is going to lead some songs. I think the first one's called Run to the Father, right? Maybe some of you need to run up here and find a place to pray. Do not worry about who is in this room or who is watching. But if you need to come to a place of repentance, don't let anything get in the way of it. The altars are going to be open. That one right over there is the one I gave my heart to Jesus. When I was a little kid. In the name of Jesus, God, as we begin to worship you, Holy Spirit, will you speak to us? Will you make us aware of your presence, Father God? Will you open the doors that only you can open? Will you shut the ones that we need to shut in our lives, God? God, will you take away the distraction for a few moments and let us just focus in on you? As we knock, as we ask, as we seek, the door. Because some of us need to go in where it's safe and get some pasture so that we can go out and then come back. Speak to the hearts. Would you stand as we worship? If you need to find a place to pray, don't wait. Run to the Father. Run to the altar. In Jesus' name. Thank you. fall into grace. Done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart found the search, my soul found a friend. So I run to the Father again and again, again.
Thank you.
trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust in God, my Savior. Who will never fail? He will never fail.
Church, let's just begin. Just begin to have a conversation with the Lord in this moment. Thank you, Lord, that you are the door. When we knock at the door in this moment,
amen.
Let's take the next 60 seconds and let's just begin to pray to the Lord. For those of you that have your spirit language, will you just begin to pray in the spirit with them? Maybe it's just because I'm standing here with the microphone, but I sense an awkwardness of desire. If you were to say, ask me one question, Pastor Jared, what's your heart's desire? My heart's desire is to cultivate, is to be a part of cultivating, not the full response, but of being a part of and leading a place of cultivating a place for the Spirit of the Lord to dwell in a greater measure. I don't know what that looks like fully, but I'm wanting to learn and grow what that looks like. So I don't know what door you're knocking on right now in this moment, but I'm knocking on the door of, Lord, teach me your ways. Moses says that in Exodus 33. Lord, teach me your ways. And then he follows that up with, show me your glory. Have you experienced the presence and the glory of the Lord in such a measure that you couldn't move or talk? I'm not wanting to create a cultivate a moment for an experience. Cultivate a moment of relationship with the presence of the King of Kings, but with the Spirit of the Living God. Because where His Spirit is, there is freedom. So we not only need to find a place of repentance, of turning away and walking towards Him, but we need to find some deliverance. And that comes by spending some time in His presence. So we're going to do, Pastor Shane and team, would you just lead us whatever song you want? You don't have to, just whatever the Lord's placing on your heart. The next minute or two, and we're going to do some praying for the coming weeks as we gather together as the body of Christ, that we would learn and that the Lord would teach us His ways of being a dwelling place for Him. So join me in praying that this morning, church. Lord, we want to be a dwelling place for You, the Spirit of the Living God.
Praising my risen King and Savior all the day long.
from the enemy,